My dear brothers and sisters, we hope you are well and that you are safe and secure. My name is Elkanah Shmatkin. At GEM, we research and produce recordings of the Rebbe and produce films about the Rebbe's life and teachings. There's really no need to explain why I'm coming to you today. The safety and security of the Jews in Israel was an issue that the Rebbe addressed thoroughly and passionately over the course of many decades, literally since the days the modern state of Israel was founded. The amount of hours the Rebbe spoke about this issue publicly, the private conversations and correspondence with Israel's political and military leaders, as well as with Jews really across the spectrum, is staggering. Now, we've produced dozens of clips, full films, and addresses by the Rebbe, but knowing a message of the Rebbe from a specific time, in one clip you'll see the Rebbe declaring that we're going to win this conflict and Hashem is with us. In another clip, you'll have the Rebbe pleading, yelling, even, that if the IDF doesn't finish the job, we will suffer for a long time and it won't end well, God forbid. Or the Rebbe's tactical guidance to an officer during a conflict. Each of these are relevant and fascinating, but they might not necessarily give you the big picture of how it all comes together in a cohesive strategy. So, to the best of my ability, I'd like to share what we've gleaned from studying the Rebbe's, or really Torah's, take on all of this. I'll do my best to take it all in and organize it into a simple, clear strategy that we can actually apply in a way that allows us to chart a clear path forward. The underlying principles that the Rebbe puts forth, and even many of the specific strategic and tactical details, are profoundly relevant today. And if you look at it, sadly, the devastation that we're experiencing now amplifies how Torah's eternal guidance is practical and actionable, and in fact, is the only way to ensure lasting peace and tranquility for our brothers and sisters in Israel. Now, if you want to go straight to the methodology, you can skip ahead to the next chapter. But before we lay that out, I'd like to just briefly go through with you, for a few moments, some actionable items that we can do at this time of war in Israel, based on specific mitzvot the Rebbe encouraged in past times of war to ensure victory over our enemies. Now, during each of Israel's conflicts, the Rebbe projected major encouragement to the IDF, to the Jews of Israel, and to our people worldwide. And he articulated Torah's assurance that as Jews, when we fight to defend ourselves as Torah requires us to, we always have been and we will be victorious. The Rebbe also repeatedly reminded us that Torah calls every single Jew the apple of God's eye. When we are united, Hashem smiles upon us and blesses our efforts, especially when we are unified in our efforts to protect ourselves. He really helped us internalize that for Jews around the world, any Jew, every Jew, to increase in Torah and mitzvot during this time, it's not just a nice thing to do, but that there is a direct line between our actions and the success of the military efforts. Now, in the days and months before each of Israel's major conflicts, the Rebbe focused on one specific mitzvah that he said is directly connected to victory on the battlefield. In the days before the Six-Day War in 1967, it was the donning of tefillin, what later came to be referred to as the tefillin campaign. In the months before the Yom Kippur War, the Rebbe urgently requested that Jewish children be gathered to share words of Torah and prayer together.
In der Fuster Mos Baelin Vienkim und Verwendfeld, Adose, wo der Possig sorgt, Adrebester, was Service Adeschem Zweis, der was vier Ton mit aller Armeen sorgt, als Lebe Heil, wie Lebe Keach, Kiem Beruchi, Omar Hawaii Zweis, Adura Dru was mit Gein Beruchi, wo das sie durch Lernen Teilo mit Keim sein Mitzwes, das versport, aber darf nicht umkommen zu Heil Vekeach, zu physischen Waffen, mit jetzt der Miet, was mir hat, die, was haben den Waffen. Und das allein warf Tone Mosova Facher, auf die alle Völker, was eine Narum Jiden bichlau und in Eretz Akedisch befragt, als sie haben gar in sich nicht kein Gedank, auf etwas, was unter ihnen, was sie verbunden mit Eretz Akedisch, Hosha viele, sie seinen Hameat Mikol Hoamin, physisch seinen sie kleinen Zoll, Ktanin, zu allegabe de andere Völker.
And before the Lebanon War, the Rebbe launched the Letter in the Torah project, in which he urged that every single Jew, every adult, every child, and especially every soldier in the IDF, purchase their own letter in a communal Torah.
Jeder soll haben einen neuen Torah, unheimlich von Ktani, 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 bis Rasheichem, Shifteichem, bis Agorlche, Bigdelim, in einer von der Sifre Torah, Aklolim, und Bekorev, Mamosh, Vyofo, Rega, Achas, Kedem, und Bemiuchot von die, was gefunden sind, und seine Medien erfinden, Begufam, Bekepschute, bis in der Nähe von Messias Nefesh soll jeder von sie jechit haben, dem Klei betochen Achi Chosan, der ist Kascheres mit Nesen der Teire, durch Hanos in der Sefer Teire, wo der Rebischter hat ihm gegeben mit der Chechi Klal Israel.
We'll share links below where you can learn about and participate in these campaigns. Now these specific mitzvot and these instructions and assurances are directly connected by Torah itself to success in conflict. They are timeless, so they certainly apply today. A small note, leading up to and during previous conflicts, one common sight was that Ben-Gurion, or at the time it was called Lod Airport, was full of Jews of foreign nationalities trying to get back to their homes outside of Israel. Even during times that were incredibly ominous, the Rebbe called on his Chassidim, on everyone really, to stick to their original plans, to remain in Israel and not to flee, assuring us that the Holy Land is the place that God's eyes are upon from the beginning of the year to the end of the year, as the verse assures us. Now today, as we all share such overwhelming concern for our brothers and sisters in the Holy Land, and so many are experiencing a crushing sense of anxiety and confusion, does all of this apply, and if so, how? By studying the Rebbe's addresses, letters, and writings on the matter, let's try to get a better understanding of how Hashem's protection of the Holy Land and His holy people works, and then we can figure out where we've gone right and where we've consistently gone wrong in the past. Hopefully, we can finally break this cycle where it seems like no matter what happens, we're back at the same place and end up with a good outcome for the long term. The Rebbe's approach to Israel's security rests on three pillars. Number one, the land of Israel belongs to the Jewish people because God gave it to us.
Wenn wir jeden Unheben erzählen, wo sie trachten, wo sie so ehren verstehen, wie er jeden Tag trachten, bin ich jetzt in Israel.
In fact, this attack began on Simchat Torah, when we begin reading the Torah. And this week, Jews around the world are reading the Torah portion of Bereshit.
Bereshit bor alekim es ha-shamayim ves ha-oretz. Und abdru shtel sachrashi, und er mefeirisch und sagt, als Oma Rabbi Yitzchak hat gesagt, loho yitzorich lehafchi lesatelo, als er kommt es, lichayelo, wo der Ebenstern nicht gedacht, anheben die Teiro, seiden elo, maachedisch az elochem, shehi mitzvah rishenu, shenitztavu bo Yisro, umatam, Posak bibreshis,
השיעים יאמרו ומסועלו, ובוס וזיין זהר טיינה, אז הם זוגן צויים, לישרוי, ליסטימט, מרזן גזלוני. ובוס ושתי דגזלו, שכבשתם ארצי שיבס גאי, was ihr hat angenommen, die Länder, was haben früher Balein zu sieben Umzäume.
If the nations of the world will confront the Jews and call them thieves, or if they call us colonizers for conquering the land of Israel, Torah wants us to reply to them that God created the world, He gave Israel to the nations, and then, 470 years after that initial promise, God fulfilled His promise, took it from them, and gave it to the Jewish people as an eternal inheritance.
Aziden soll nicht misspoll werden und nicht erschrecken sich und nicht kriegen sich und mazbe sein dosei mit aseichot mit pashtus. Kol hooret shela kodesh borchu a de ganze Welt, de ganze Erd gehört zu dem Eibischten. In was veranesm hu bro erotir baschaffen. Und danach und es sonno lacher Joscher beinno. Und danach hat auch gegeben, die Themen von der Welt, jederin zu dem lacher Joscher beinno, was bei ihm ist gekommen, also sich gleich, man soll das ihm geben.
And the Rebbe meant this very practically, and he says that is exactly how Rashi meant it. Rashi lived in the Middle Ages. You know, a Jew's standing in those days was not very high in society. But nevertheless, he says that God opened the entire Torah from Bereshit rather than the first commandment to the Jewish people, only so that we can and should use this argument. On many occasions, the Rebbe maintained strongly that Israel's leaders must understand where our ownership of this land comes from, that they need to actually believe it, and that they must repeat it to others. And this is the only argument that can really work. Our mandate to this land does not come from the UN. Resolution number this or that doesn't constitute our connection to Eretz Yisrael. Our deed to this land is the Torah, or if you need the English for that, that's the Old Testament. In today's world, when every one of us is on the front lines of Hasbara, and for ourselves as well, we all need to know this. The second pillar of the Rebbe's approach is the Code of Jewish Law, Laws of Shabbat, Chapter 329, paragraphs 6 and 7, which states, if non-Jews besiege a city of Jews on Shabbat and they're demanding money, you may not desecrate the Shabbat to protect yourselves. If they come to kill, or without explaining their reason, you must desecrate Shabbos to protect yourselves and go out to confront them with weapons. Now, if the city is near the border, even if they come demanding only straw or hay, you must desecrate the Shabbat and fight them off by all means possible. And the reason, it states, in order that the rest of the land should not become easy for them to conquer. The Rama adds that even if they haven't actually arrived at the city, they just want to come, and we learn of it, we must go out with weapons to stop them. In other words, according to halacha, to Jewish law, we are obligated to preserve our security at all costs, even launching a preemptive strike, if necessary, to neutralize any threat to Jewish life and on Shabbat. Over and over and over again, the Rebbe underscored the importance of deterrence, emphasizing that according to Torah, projecting strength is the most effective, the only effective deterrent. And by the way, this law ordering us to desecrate Shabbat in order to protect life applies not only in Israel. In fact, anywhere Jews live. The Talmudic source for this law speaks about Neharda, a city in Babylon during the Second Temple, which is located near Iraq of today. So this pillar is not even connected specifically with the holiness of Eretz Yisrael.
Chas v'sholem ibertrachten, wegen mekayim sein dem Diener Shulchan Aruch Eira Chayim, Hilche Shabbos, Simen Shin Chof Tes, as jeder Jid und alle Jiden stehen gerät auf Baschitzen, jeder Teil von Eretz Yisroel, und nicht nur Eretz Yisroel lechet den Chutzloret, wo a Jid gefinzer, macht der von a heilige Teil in der Land, in der Medina, wo gefinzer, und darf das Baschitzen,
lei den Obpartloren Psagdin von den Nebischen, beterose was i teras chayim und teras emes, und erret a riesigem den Kloren Psagdin, a wu nor se leben iden, zieh in eres a kedisch zehn Chuslort, und se kommt se gehen Goyischkeit, und sie kommen zu gehen Goyim und sie sagen, dass sie wollen zunehmen dem Nuchas HaNefesh der Ruhigkeit, weil das sie verbunden mit Lernen Teir und mit keinem sein Mitzvies. AVP, wo sie sagen, dass sie mehr nicht wie eine Kleinigkeit, Kasch mit Teven, sagt der Rebester in den Psag Dien. Also bei Schabbos darf man sich stellen mit der ganzen Starkheit. Zieh das sie in Chutzlores, zieh das sie in Eretz HaKedesh und kein Unterschied und es sichert Maftiach. Aber wie bald habe ich die Kreisheit der Leiche, was mit Weisheit ist mehr. Aber wie bald habe ich mit keinem sein unter dem Pschag dien, is a sichere Sach, wenn er sagt, die Scholl im Behoret. Durer der Ruf, und das ist der einzige Weg, als es sein der Emeser Scholl, Behoret in Eretz HaKedesh, der Emeser Scholl, wo nur jeden gefunden sagt.
As a note, the Rebbe would emphasize that this approach saves not only Jewish lives, but also spares many lives on the enemy side. I really want to keep this video general and not get too deep into the weeds, but there's one sub-theme of this point that I should mention now. When you're in a conflict, finish the job, the Rebbe urged. Finish the job, finish the job. We'll pin an address of the Rebbe on this topic from during the Lebanon War. And the third pillar, as I understand it, is humility. After the Six-Day War, and even after the Yom Kippur War, once Israel regained its footing and went forward full force and did manage to eventually eke out a victory, the Rebbe emphasized how basically all members of the security forces called those victories miraculous. But then, over time, the events eventually became reframed as the vaunted and undefeatable IDF pulled through. The Rebbe protested strongly. He was extremely alarmed by the hubris and felt that it was even dangerous. At all times, but especially when we succeed, we must recognize God's protection and his overt and miraculous intervention. But here's where it gets interesting. These three pillars work as a trio, and a very interesting loop begins to happen here. On the one hand, we say God is the only one who provides protection. The only real protection comes from God. And on the other hand, God wants us to take up arms, to secure our borders, to make strategic decisions based exclusively on security considerations and no other considerations whatsoever. And when we do that to the fullest, then Hashem continues to bless our efforts with supernatural success, as he has in the past. Now, understanding these three pillars and how they work together also helps explain some things that I think are conspicuously and intentionally absent from the Rebbe's approach to Israel. And these don'ts are just as important as the do's. The Rebbe did not spend any time focusing on explaining what kind of savages our enemies are. He did not at all subscribe to the notions that I've heard time and again, that this time our enemies went so far, this time the world is finally going to understand Israel's position and will back us, this time we can deal with our enemies differently. The support of the world, and especially our allies, is important and it's wonderful, but it can never serve as the basis of our security strategy. And sadly, not taking this approach has had deadly consequences. The most well-known of these is the disastrous start of the Yom Kippur War. And we must be focused on our internal well-being, our confidence, our clarity in the righteousness of what we are doing comes from us, not from how many countries did or did not put out statements supporting or condemning us. There is a place for hasbara in warfare. Propaganda is a central element of fighting a war. But our morale, our sense of success or failure, cannot come from whether some influencer or even some government likes what we're doing. The solution to our problems is going to come from deep inside of us. The world never did and never will solve our problems. But here's a really nice catch. When we do what we need to do, meaning when our actions match our deeply held Jewish beliefs, and we do what Hashem tells us to do, and we succeed, we will then gain the respect of the world. Before concluding, I want to state there are many, many difficult sub-issues that the Rebbe addressed. A couple of examples: redeeming hostages at a disproportionate price, capturing terrorists versus killing them. How can you ignore America and even ignore American Jewry when we're so reliant on the U.S. for arms and international protection? Making accords with and arming friendly Arab nations. That's a big one right now. An example of a very specific case that was brought to the Rebbe by a very senior Israeli official was if a terrorist departs from an Arab village and you know that the whole village knew that he was going and they helped prepare him. Do you punish the whole village? Do you need to punish the whole village so the next village won't do that? There are hundreds of specific situations, but they're very specific. So let's spend a little bit of time absorbing this worldview and living by it. And then we can hopefully add more to the playlist below. And make sure to like and follow to catch the other videos right when we upload them. So here's a quick summary of the action items for now. For us, Jewish unity. God loves every one of us, but when we are united, He smiles on us in an even greater way and grants us success. Mitzvot, the commandments that God gave us, the same God who gave us this land, and in particular, tefillin, Torah study by children, and the letter in the Torah scroll. As Jews, we're connected, so whether we've chosen to or not, we're all in Hasbara. We need to remind ourselves and tell to others that we own this place because God gave it to us, and we need to defend ourselves. And for Israel's leaders, all of the above, plus understand well and internalize that your foremost responsibility, in fact, it's your job, almost the exclusion of all else, is to protect Jewish lives. Align your security strategy and policies in this way, and everything else will fall into place. That's it for today. I hope this was helpful. Brothers and sisters, let's stick together. With Hashem's help, we will be victorious.